again, see what an embarrassment of riches really is. We pulled the chairs out of the conference room, out of the back, all the chairs we have. So I think we need a new building. I'm really excited to announce our speaker tonight, but first I'll give you a couple of announcements because I've been hearing things trickling in from the community, and part of it is I try to do what I can to let you all know in advance as much as possible, but also to tell you that I don't have all the answers because things are evolving and changing, and we have to be really open to that. But since this is the first third Thursday of our new year, you've heard me say that when you live in semesters, this is our new year, we're really happy to have you all here. You know, the general timeline, as it stands, and it could change, is that Phi Beta Kappa, theater and dance next door, are going to move out this summer. Now, right now, the idea, as I've heard it, is they were going to tear down 60% of Phi Beta Kappa. It may be more. You all know how close we are to that monolith. And the idea of trying to stay open when they're tearing this down seems to be unsafe, potentially, and daunting. I watched them tear down Millington, the old biology building, and it was a maelstrom. They literally hacked it down. Just, you know, things. So the idea that we would move off-site this summer, you know, the shows are going to end right with graduation. You all know that after graduation happens, the campus becomes very quiet, at least until summer school comes back, but it's still pretty quiet. And the idea that we could move off-site, put the collection in appropriate museum quality storage, and find ourselves a home was the general idea. Well, that's starting to come into focus. We had our board meetings last week. We had the board of visitors here, the leadership boards of the college to see this wonderful embarrassment and riches of both this show and the one upstairs. So a couple of new committees were formed to work on things like strategic planning, development and messaging, for all kinds of reasons, right? Whether it's for membership, for advertising purposes. You know, the scare is that you go dark. We're not talking about going dark. We're going for an interim period for which, if we are successful and we negotiate a downtown venue that has parking, students can walk to, and we can even have, and we will have, a number of series of social events. We'll figure out how we're going to have the third Thursdays and the first Tuesdays, where we could do that, whether in town or on campus. We're going to look into what the recommendations of our board committee really are in terms of maintaining that brand. But I can tell you right now, we may do some other social and fun things like martinis at the Muscarelli or margaritas at the Muscarelli. I don't know why those M words are always associated with cocktails, but you know, the idea is to stay in the public eye in as positive a way as we can for our brand. Don't have all the exact answers for that, but we had a session at the board meeting that talked about everything from social events to using a space that that we're looking at, which contains basically a gallery, on the evolution of design and the building of the museum. Maybe there's other things that we can do that don't have to be in a place that has museum quality standards of condition and all this, but can still bring people out at least once a month. And if you have parking, more than we have right now, that could be really conducive for us. So here's something that I'm going to need your help. Someone said, well, what is my membership going to get me when the museum is closed? Well, let me tell you, let's think of membership as an investment in the future. I mean, a lot of people, when you look at membership, they're not really becoming a member to be have the benefits. They want to be engaged, they want to help, and they want to support. And I need you all as ambassadors to help with that message, because it's going to be very important that we have a very central location with our big yellow and white logo and a place that you can come, but it won't be a traditional museum. It's going to be something else for 2 years. And so we're really excited about this, but if you can imagine this whole area fenced off as a construction site, they're going to stage from the circle out front, and they're going to build three buildings at one time, or that's what we hope and plan. The college has been very good by saying, hey, if you want to stay in the building for 6 extra months, I'm like, yeah, cinder blocks falling. I don't really want to do that. So that's going to be good, but we don't have all the answers specifically right now, but we are working on this. And so you know, everything from what are the doses going to do, what are the friends going to do. Well, we might have to beg for your patience in many ways, just like you all. So we will continue to have the programs, and we'll just figure out where. Now, I do have a slightly negative thing to say, and that is there will be no reception tonight because our good friend Mark Hanna, who, as you know, worked with Virginia Company Bank and started the Third Thursdays and sponsoring the receptions, and then went through a bank merger to EVB, and he stayed on, and EVB picked it up. Well, I'm stating factually that Sana Bank did not, the third merger, and Mark, in fact, lost his job, and he's going off to be a bank president in Harrisonburg. So we wish him well, but I'm not going to go out. I've got several people that want to sponsor this program. I'm not going to do that until we figure out where it's going to live and be, because I don't want to just do three of them and then stop, and it just seems so inconsistent. But so I hope you appreciate that. And so, you know, sometimes these good things have to come to an end, free wine and stuff. But then again, I saw hundreds of you all at the members' opening on Friday night, and maybe that'll make up for a lot of you. But the opening, we had over 600 kids Saturday night, the student opening, the Board of Visitors, and the leadership boards came Thursday night, so we're very happy. So let's get to the topic at hand. It starts with this beautiful red book. This is my copy, which I've had for 20 years. And you see all these little dog-eared tabs, because what we did, and when John and I thought about what do we do as one of our last exhibitions before we close, we knew we wanted to anticipate the 100th anniversary celebration that the college is going to embark upon in September, of the first woman coming to the college. For clothes, we couldn't participate, so we thought, well, how do we anticipate the celebration? We couldn't really use their logos and things like that, but we had a chance to shamelessly show, you know, some of the great women artists in our collection, and half these works are somewhat new acquisitions over the past so many years, so we're proud about that. We thought, upstairs, what is our brand, right? Our brand is for something that nobody else really can do, certainly at a museum of our size, and that is put together an old master exhibition. And I've spent over 20 years with colleagues throughout the South and Southeast, and I thought, you know what? I'm going to take Dennis's book. I'm going to go look at where these pictures are at Bob Jones University, at his museum. I thought about the Ringling, the Chrysler, the National Gallery, with our two acquisitions. And I basically rode around for a week in the spring asking my friends for a favor. Unfortunately, Dennis wasn't there, but I met with the long-time director of the North Carolina Museum of Art. So we really have to thank our colleagues for putting this together and working with us in a matter of just less than a year. Secondly, I wanted to thank Dennis. And the reason why we've asked him to be here, one, we've known him for so long, but two, this is the 20th anniversary of his groundbreaking show. His show was Saints and Sinners, Darkness and Light, Caravaggio and his Dutch and Flemish Followers. And what he did is he cataloged all of the Caravaggisti in the pictures, basically in the country, and where they were and by what artists, so you could actually go through. It's a monumental task that we did, but this was in 1998, and so that was how we arrived at the possibility of focusing on two of our new acquisitions, the Barberin and the Byler, if you haven't seen the show, and also do something as a swan song that was, we hope, is memorable, and obviously then gets to mark a tradition of one of our great colleagues. So I'm introducing you to Dennis Weller, who's been the curator of Northern European art at the North Carolina Museum of Art since 1995. That's the same year I went to the Ringling Museum when we were youngsters. He's also been an adjunct professor at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. His PhD is from the University of Maryland in 1992. He's been a recipient of a Fulbright and a Marit South Fellowship. Spent 5 years at the National Gallery of Art in Washington. And he also spent some time at the Metropolitan Museum of Art as a Mellon postdoctoral fellow. So this is really something very famous. Dennis has done many shows. One that we can't gloss over was Rembrandt in America. And this was in 2011. So in some ways, Dennis at North Carolina he's punching above his weight class in many ways, though that is a great, great museum and a great, great collection. But really, the Saints and Sinners, Darkness and Light, that was in 1998. He's written many articles, many catalogs, lectured many times. And one thing I found very interesting is, like our own Dr. John Spike, you may not know this, but John was the director of the Florence Biennale, the largest contemporary art show in the world, for 7 years. So people can have extremely diverse interests outside of what may or may not be their supposed expertise, and Dennis is the same. He's very interested in contemporary photography and has done two exhibitions and written catalogs and articles, and one of them I found very interesting is one I thought I saw, is Seeing, Believing, the Real, the Surreal, the Unreal in Contemporary Photography. So you talk about wild diversity and what one does. I would like you to join me in welcoming our friend Dennis Weller to the podium. Caravaggio in America is this painting here. It came to the Wadsworth Athenaeum. And
by a very forward-looking director of the time, Chick Austin, and he is, again, part and parcel of what you find in early Caravaggio in terms of his art. It is, I think, important to realize that with the St. Francis that came in 43, with the Kansas City painting in 52, and then with all the other artists, Caravaggio's The Faller, there was not that much available for museums to buy. And early on, other than the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Caravaggios did not go to Washington's National Gallery, not to Boston, not to Chicago. They did eventually make their way to Detroit, Kansas City, Wadsworth Athenaeum, Cleveland, and then a couple from that. But again, it was a very quick turnaround. And what was happening was that you would have artists responding to Caravaggio's, those that went to Rome, and even those who didn't make their way to Rome, through intermediaries as much as seeing actual Caravaggio's. And the great intermediary was a man named Bartolomeo Manfredi. And Manfredi, and we see one of his paintings here, this is the Allegory of the Four Seasons, the Dayton Art Institute, a gift given by the McDonald family, and it dates about 1610. This is a year that by then Caravaggio had left Rome. But it has been documented that Manfredi evolved, or Katsuo was called the Manfredi method. How to find shortcuts to affect a way that Caravaggio painted. And that was this drama, this theatricality, this realism. And it could be with secular subject matter, this year, or it could be religious subjects. Nevertheless, Manfredi was the go-between, and with my Sinners and Saints show, I wanted to show a couple of Manfredis. So we had this painting from Dayton. There was a painting from the Memphis Brooks Museum. I'm not showing you tonight, but what I wanted to do is set the stage with that Caravaggio, with that Manfredi. But then one looks at what's happening elsewhere, and just to show you where Caravaggio with the comparable subject matter, here's the Manfredi, and Manfredi had looked at Caravaggio. And this Caravaggio, the model is a boy with fruit, also thought to be a self-portrait in the guise of Bacchus. And this is at the Borghese, one of his first great individual to sponsor Caravaggio through a commission works from him, dates 1595. So this is happening very early in the Baroque period. In fact, it's one strain in the Baroque when you think about Caravaggio and what he brought with his style. But Caravaggio's long reach then included a lot of artists, and that's what I want to briefly look at tonight. Here's another Caravaggio. People might recognize this. This is the Great Entombment. And this is the Vatican collection. This is a little bit later, 1603-04. And lo and behold, if you think about collecting in America, now this stays in the Vatican. But if you go up to Ottawa, you'll find this painting. This is the copy after the Great Entombment by Caravaggio, by none other than Peter Paul Rubens. And you don't usually put Rubens in the Caravaggio's following grouping because Rubens was a genius in his own right. He was really one of the, if not the greatest innovators of the Baroque, certainly one of the greatest geniuses to ever pick up a brush or a whatever. I mean, he did it all. Linguist, architect, you know. In any event, he also had the wherewithal to make a copy after the Caravaggio, and again, by this time, he painted this in about 1612 or 14, is usually identified, and that's after he had spent time in Rome and elsewhere in Italy, and then made his way back to Antwerp. And he was in Antwerp 1608 or 09, and again, understanding what was happening in Rome, and it was through kind of the artistic grapevine that people learned about Caravaggio. They wanted to go visit. And there were many, many followers. And upstairs, you can count quite a number of them, including some artists who may not have gone to Italy, but most of them had. Rembrandt, for example, didn't go to Italy to look at Italian art and Caravaggio, but he certainly understood what was happening. So in terms of what's really going on, you think about these artists from particular cities. And with Caravaggio, we talk about the Utrecht Caravaggisti. So those artists from the Dutch city of Utrecht, which remained largely Catholic in the 17th century. There were certainly connections with Rome in the 17th century. And there are three Bergen, Hontorst, but Warren. And very well represented here and represented in my exhibition. And here is a Caravaggio or a Terebrugge you'll find upstairs. And I've always called Terebrugge the poor man's Caravaggio. Because when you think about collecting history, okay, if you can get a Caravaggio, power to you, and only a handful of museums in America could do that. But if you wanted the poor man's Caravaggio, you can go to Smith College. You can go to the North Carolina Museum of Art, where there are two Terebruggens. You can go to the Chrysler. I mean, they're all over, university museums as well as public museums. And while now you might spend $8, $10 million for a Terebruggen, back in the day, back in the 50s, and that's when we're really talking about it, they weren't nearly as expensive. But nevertheless, they are really quite powerful paintings. And Terebrugge really has come into his own. This is the Martyr of St. Catherine, 1622-25. So a painting that was done after Terebrugge had spent time in Rome. In fact, he seems to have been there, certainly one of the first artists to go to Rome in this group, and he may in fact have met Caravaggio. There was just a very narrow bit of crossover in terms of when Caravaggio was still in Rome and when Terebrugge arrived. And it is amazing what he produced during this time period. So there are a few examples early in his career, about the time he came back from Rome. There's certainly a lot of questions about the dating of these early works, but nevertheless, he was building on what he had seen in terms of figure placement and lighting, naturalism to the figures, relationship between figures, and certainly this lovely painting here from the Chrysler Museum is one of those early examples. Now, in my mind, if I had to pick a Terebrugge in America to have, I would hang this in anywhere. I mean, this is really one of the great examples, 1625, St. Sebastian attended by St. Irene. This is not at the Met, not in Boston, Chicago. This is at the Allen Art Museum at Oberlin College in Ohio. And again, poor man's Caravaggio. Certain individuals, Wolfgang Steckow, for example, is a great professor there. He had a role to play in this acquisition, and it was acquired in 1953. So again, this period just after World War II, Caravaggio had begun to appear as a major entity, and then as all these followers were being identified and coming to America in great numbers. Now, Smith College, this is their Terebrugge. It's an old man riding by candlelight, dates 1626-27. They acquired this painting in 1957. Again, a wonderful example by this great master, Terebrugge. Dayton, Ohio has a version of this particular boy, the violin player, 1626. There was another version that was in a private collection in New York until about 20 years, about the time of my show, but I had this painting in the show. And again, these secular figures writing, playing musical instruments, it's all part of a larger picture of a changing of subject matter, not just portraits and religious subject matter, but much more secular subject matter coming in as well. And there might be then references to the five senses, to virtue and vice, and some of these figures as well. So the excellent wall labels upstairs will tell you more about some of the subject matter that can be discussed. Bagpipe player upstairs. Very interesting acquisition by the National Gallery. The National Gallery, for all of its great collection, even though it doesn't yet have and probably will never get a Caravaggio, they did not even have an Utrecht Caravaggist painting until they acquired this in 2009. They were behind the many of the other museums in America and many other college museums in America in acquiring Utrecht Caravaggisti, but they did finally get this in 2009, a wonderful example by the artist. And then my museum, which opened to the public in 1956, after the state appropriated $1 million to buy art in 1947, it took 9 years to put it all together, and when they did, they had not this painting on the wall, but a promise painting that came with the great gift of the Crest Collection, Press Foundation in 1960. And example of Terreburg really compressing space, as so many Karavadas paintings did. So a very forward-looking. It is interesting how he places the figure of the head of Goliath. The Goliath here, right here. His flesh is even turning a little bit green. We like to hang this low enough so the school children. it's a great painting. There's a version of this in Sibiu, Romania that I went to see. I mean, if there's a version, you've got to go to Romania to see it. And this is the prime version. That was, I would say, a weak copy, to say the least. Now, when you talk about copies, and this is part of the minefield you walk through when you deal with some of these colors, we have, for example, this painting in Raleigh. It is, man. Little boy holding a wine glass, and it has some beautiful painted passages, particularly the candlelight behind the hand and the glass. But it's also a painting that has serious damage. We hang it kind of high because there have been losses to the side of the face here. You just don't have that detail, and you don't have the contours and modeling. And the same with the back of the hand. All in all, it's a fine painting, but again, you've got to deal with these issues as a director and a curator. You want to put your best foot forward, and you want things framed properly, you want them clean, etc. Now, this whole idea about primary versions, secondary versions, came to the fore when this painting came to market not long ago. And I just can't accept this as a Terreburg, and there was just a different feeling about how it's painted. But it was, they tried to sell it to Terreburg, and I think it kind of went down the ladder, maybe circle of or follow of, but in any event, using the same overall composition. Take a breath, I guess. Now, in addition to Terreburg, and as one of the great Utrecht Karavagisti, and the first of the group that really made their way down there, the second of these is the artist responsible here. This is Baboren. And certainly Baboren you know now because you have the example here at the museum, because you have a recent purchase. Now, Baboren was born about 1590, died 1624, so a very short life. But like Terreburg, did versions and variants. He was in Rome about 1611, so long after Caravaggio had gone, long after Terreburg had come to Rome. And one of my favorite paintings by him, which I'm also very grateful that Kansas City and Nelson Atkins lent to me for my show, along with the Caravaggio. Not bad to get these two. Was Christ Crown of Thorns. Now, I first saw this painting when it was hanging at the National Gallery as a possible purchase. Way back when I don't know if I was an intern then or I was assistant curator. But in any event, the director there at the time just wasn't buying into Dutch realism for one reason or another. So he passed on it, Kansas City bought it, and it really is one of the great Karavadas paintings in America. This is done in two versions. This one here, the autograph in Kansas City. There's also a version, this version here. What I can do is look at the face of the person in the upper left-hand corner. Kansas City version, you can see the face. The version of the St. Catherine's Convent in Utrecht, in the Netherlands, he's covered by part of that. So kind of compressing the figures, but again, the prototypic Karavadas composition is there, the lighting is there. And really a fine example in two versions, seemingly both are autographed by the artist. That's one of my favorite paintings for lots of reasons, but I'll get back to that in a bit. We have the before and here now. It is a Narcissus. I was going to bring you a slide of a Narcissus by a kind of a down the Karavadas list of artists at the Ringling Museum. I didn't bring that in, but it's a fine acquisition here that, again, kind of changes the complexion of a collection. You can bring in a major artist such as Baboren, so I was happy to see it on the wall. I've never seen this painting before. Now, another Baboren, that's what I really was going to talk about. Here's a painting by Baboren that is at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. And if you look very carefully, you'll see that you have some sort of discussion going on between a young buxom woman, an older woman who seems to be putting her hand, wanting money, and then the customer, in a general way to say it, you see there. This is the choir.
major museum.
And I always like to say the
customer looks a lot like Kirk Douglas.
Churches, in the collections, and then coming back north and reinventing northern painting in the guise of Caravaggio, at least for a period of time, about a 20-year period, from about 1610 to 30 or so, that was very popular. But it makes its way into other arts, because the painting that I'm talking about, you might notice, is right up here. Now, unfortunately, this is the painting at the Gardner Museum that was stolen 20 years ago or something. And I still think they're going to find these paintings. They'll be, someone will smell gas in a neighborhood and they'll go into a house and you've got Vermeer's and Rembrandt. But in any event, Vermeer gets stolen and then recovered. But here you have that painting. And it suggests that, well, certainly Vermeer, who's working a generation and a half later, Vermeer was born in 1632. So much later in time. This is after Bourne died, after Terburgen died, after Caravaggio died. So, but aware of his art, and the idea is that his father seems to have been a bit of an art dealer, and Vermeer would have perhaps inherited things and shows those in this wonderful painting here. And it was so nice. You literally could see that Bourne at the MFA walked literally around the block, around the corner, and go to the Gardner Museum to see this painting. Not anymore. Vermeer, in his own right, could take a Caravaggesque approach to subject matter. And certainly if you know anything about Vermeer, you know that early in his career, he was more interested in history painting, religious, mythological, and larger figures. And this is one of his earlier works in Procurus. And this is in Dresden. It's been fairly recently cleaned from the time I first saw it. An early, fully dated painting by him, 1656. And a lot of what we saw with the Bourne, they go back to subject matter wise, placing the figure, his degree, lighting, palette a little different, certainly, but nevertheless, it's not only that he knew of this painting, but he learned from that painting and he worked this out in this composition. And it's the one painting by Vermeer we think this may well be a self-portrait. But again, what are you comparing it to? We can say it is. Again, note the placement of these figures. Note this wonderful table carpet and all the accoutrements that go with the Procurus. Now, what about these artists? Vermeer didn't go to Italy. We don't even know who Vermeer studied with. We don't even know who Vermeer, where he studied. Maybe Utrecht. There's been one theory, but we don't know. Fabricius' name comes up. He died, and early on, his painting was very different. So we know that these ideas came and went, but we also know that there were many followers of Caravaggio. In addition to Vermeer later, there are these followers who worked at the same time that the Utrecht Caravaggistes were getting started, and then the artists in Antwerp and elsewhere, and certainly one of those is Frans Hals. Now, I've been doing a lot of work on Frans Hals and the topic of Frans Hals in America recently, and this is one of these great Frans Hals that came to America. It is at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. It's unfortunately one of these great paintings by Frans Hals that will never travel because of the stipulations and when it was given and who gave it. Nevertheless, the Shrovetide Revelers dates 1620s. Some date as early as 1616, so exactly when these followers of Caravaggio were coming back to Utrecht and to Antwerp and to other cities. So he was kind of making part of this approach compositionally in works such as this, but with Hals, there's also the added impact of the high spirits of the sitters, the very active brushwork, I mean, and true genius, and one of the reasons why I'm so interested in working with Hals. his approach as the years passed was becoming a little bit more classicizing in terms of how he composed his figures within space, the space behind them. But here you have that dark background, which is typical of Caravaggio as well, and his foreground placement of very realistic figures. But he is better known as being part of the Harlem classicism, and that, as I said, comes a little bit later in his art. And then there's probably the most famous painting from the collection in North Carolina Museum of Art. This is the Feast of Esther by Jan Leavens, who was Rembrandt's contemporary, actually more precocious than Rembrandt early on, but a year younger, but made his name even earlier than Rembrandt. This is a painting that was called Rembrandt for a few decades after it was acquired by the North Carolina Museum of Art. Dates about 1625, part of the initial purchases for the museum in 1952, and it is literally what you would think of if you think of early Leavens. Large figure, garish colors, kind of a Caravaggesque placement of the figures in the foreground. While you don't have a dark background, you have a background that doesn't take you further beyond those curtains. You couldn't talk, as I say, more about it being by Leavens than if you had a fully signed and dated Leavens. No, this isn't either signed or dated, but it certainly is by Leavens. Now, the reason I mention this is that, having been thought to be by Rembrandt, the question is, what was Rembrandt doing about this time? What Rembrandt was doing was smaller scale, more, I think, psychologically subtle, a little bit more in terms of a tonal palette. This is a Rembrandt that dates just a year or two after the Leavens of this song. It's called The Moneylender. It's in Berlin, so it's not part of the history of American collecting, but nevertheless, it shows you what Rembrandt was most interested in about the same time period. Now, a very famous author of the time, historian, a man named Constantine Halkitz, wrote about the difference between Rembrandt and Leavens. By the time he was seeing them in their studios, this young, beardless artist, he urging them to go to Italy. They said, I see plenty of Italian art, it's staying in the Netherlands, so the rest is history. Rembrandt went like this, Leavens more or less went like this, but that was their choice, I would say. Now, we also have our museum, this work. Again, not dissimilar to what we've been seeing before in terms of figure placement, realism, lack of background. But this is by not a Dutch painter, but it is by a painter from the Southern Netherlands. And the Southern Netherlands was controlled by the Spanish during this time period. The center of its art world was Antwerp, which is where Rubens was. But if we talk about the big three, Utrecht, Caravaggio, we could also talk about the big three in Antwerp. I would say Rubens is one, obviously. Then you've got Anthony van Dyck. And then third, Jacob Jordaens. Jacob Jordaens knew what was happening in Italy, although he didn't go there. He knew through Rubens and the other followers of Caravaggio, so I'm very pleased that we have this in our collection. This was part of my Sinners and Saints show. It's the Holy Family, or it's the Virgin Child of St. John and his parents, it dates about 1616 and 1617. We also have in the collection, and now you'll see it upstairs, is probably the one of the more interesting and one of the more difficult artists to really get a sense of. His name is Matthias Stone, or sometimes you see it spelled Stone. He was from Amersfoort, I think, or which is near Utrecht, born about 1600. And he died after 1652, maybe in Sicily, maybe in northern Italy. We do know that he probably career progressed. He was born in 1592. He died in 1656. He studied with Glomar, who was a very important painter, a very important teacher in Utrecht. He was in Rome by about 1610 or so. There he had major patrons and commissions, and back in Utrecht about 1620, because we know information about the big party that was given in his honor in return. He showed this strong debt to Caravaggio, and he has a palette that I think is more distinctive than his contemporaries. He became more classical in tone and lighter in tone as career progressed, and he just created some great, great images. Here we have a painting. It's in St. Louis. It is a Procurus, dated 1625. It was acquired in 1954. So a fairly daring acquisition for a Midwestern art museum in 54. Plenty of neckline. And what she's holding is a wonderful little image. Probably on it could be copper, it could be wood, we don't know. But it has a little inscription. And my Dutch is okay, but I'm going to kind of paraphrase here. It says, you can't mind Nars. Now, Nars is a polite way, not such a polite way of saying your backside. Can I get some help here? Anyway, what it's saying is, who knows my backside from the backside? So, seeing her front and back, she's offering herself. And certainly, these images of courtesans were popular at the time. Caravaggism, as we knew it from the 1610s and 20s, is really very pleased, and this is not a great slide, but recently we were able to reframe that. So it's in just a kind of a nondescript gold Louis, one of the Louis frames before, so now I have in a frame. I think it's more in keeping with the nature of the painting and when it was produced. Now, not done with that, because we also have in Raleigh a new painting by Harold Sayles. And I don't know if I would call this a bargain. We bought it at Christie's in Paris. And we knew that there were some conservation issues, but it was very inexpensive. And it came to us, and we thought, oh, beautiful, I love this blue dress. And then we took it to our conservation lab. And we have a full conservation lab with all the bells and whistles, all the ways of looking underneath the surface. And lo and behold, this is how she looks today. A vase or a blue dress, which probably made well and has later some boxes. It was a later addition. So we removed the blue, and we're now in the process of cleaning it up, if you will, lots of in painting. This is painted on top of another painting. Part of the figure has been scraped out. So it had a long history. The canvas additions on the sides, when you did this, there's some issues with those. This is now, they've been cleaned, but now it's a varnish, a slight tinted varnish to kind of reduce that. And I'm happy that this flute player here, and this date, I think I've got a date, about 1630, 2025. This is earlier, we think, than the painting just saw the Nile of St. Peter. But a nice example by the artist, and I'm pleased to say that we already have a new frame for it. So we just kind of put that in photographically, but once it's clean, it'll be on the walls. This will go into our 17th century Flemish Plymouth complex, all done. So kind of fun project. Now, loop players abound in a lot of these paintings, and our next artist to look at briefly is a man named Rombouts. Theodore Rombouts, he was of that earlier generation, but he was born about 1597 and died in 1637. So many of these artists were fairly short-lived. But this loop player here is one that comes from the Philadelphia Museum of Art. And if you consider this as Caravaggesque, it's, you know, just in kind of looks like it, smelled like it must be. Nevertheless, this is one of the first examples that really came to America because this is a painting that was in the Johnson collection. And Mr. Johnson was the lawyer for Morgan, and he amassed an enormous collection that he eventually gave to the city of Philadelphia. And the Johnson collection, Philadelphia Museum of Art, is really quite extraordinary. Now, he was thrifty, to say. So he didn't buy your major Rembrandts and Halses. I mean, he kind of worked on the borders. He could never compete with the Morgans and the Fricks and the Wagners, those that were really buying on that scale at the time. But he did bring in just an incredible variety of different artists and subjects. And this Sager's, or this Rombouts here, he would have acquired, we think, by about 1912. So now we're jumping way back in time if you look at something. So this is the Rombouts in Philadelphia. Then we have the Rombouts at upstate. And this is also a painting that came to our collection as the North Carolina Museum of Art, and is called the Backgammon Players, 1634. And this was acquired in 1957. So it was a generous gift by donors right after our museum opened. Now we're beginning to distance ourselves from what we would call kind of core Caravaggism, in that you have classical architecture in the background. The figures are defining more space from foreground to into the middle ground. The label upstairs goes in quite nice detail about all this in that last room. But nevertheless, it is a kind of the lingering, if you will, aftermath of Caravaggism from the time period, which certainly, like I say, it was really a phenomenon from the 10s and the 20s, but you can even move into the 30s and see that lingering in this example. Much more, I think, 1975, and he died in 1632. He was recorded in Italy much earlier than these other artists we talked about. He was there in 1598, other than Rubens. Rubens was there about the same time as well, but all these other characters became later. So he's in Italy about 1598, he left in 1601. Until Rubens reappeared on the scene after spending his 8 years in Rome, it was Janssens who really had control from the major actors, or major patrons, came to him, and he was able to produce serious altarpieces, etc. His subject matter could be both secular and historical, both religious and mythological. And here we have a Philemon and Baucis, which is not in the show, it was in my show. This comes from the Davis Museum at Wellesley, acquired by them in 1954. Again, another one of these colleges early on looking to this type of work. You have Philemon and Baucis, the couple who allowed the gods to come into their household not knowing who they were very generous, would even sacrifice their last duck for them. And once they discovered the identity of the gods, now they kind of come into godly pose, if you will. In any event, their only wish is that they would die at the same time, and they were turned into juniper trees. I can't remember. Anyway, outside their doorway, this love story continuing. But note the way in which the still life on the table is described. You think of Caravaggio that we saw. The example of my man Trey, the placement of the figures, the dark background, all of that is showing you that Janssens is certainly understanding early on what was happening with Caravaggio. Here we have the painting upstairs, one of them St. Jerome from the Chrysler Museum, fairly early. This is 1610 or 12, again, earlier than most of what we've been seeing. They acquired it in 1971.
I must have a late-breaking notice. Yes. The return of a crate light on it to inspect the condition after the travel. Yeah. We found the date 1613.
What did I say? 12. I'm a year old. Okay. That's breaking news. For us art historians and curators, that's a big deal. And there is another version of this as well, which I say is not unusual to have other versions, but you have the same from 1613. Another painting upstairs. This is Lamentation over the Dead Body of Christ, 1610 or 12, unless we found a new date. This is Bob Jones University. Probably the slickest varnish I've ever seen, glossiest varnish I've seen on a painting in a few years. But, you know, that's part of the history and part of appreciating old masters. I mean, you see them clean, you see them dirty, you see them dull varnish, and sometimes we talk about varnish sinking, so kind of dead area. But anyway, a wonderful composition and something quite large and powerful, and you can see the surface of all the pieces. Now, the last painter I want to look at is another major acquisition here, is a painting by Johann Bayreuth, who was born 1597-98, died in 1671, so a very long career. And again, like others, moved to a less tarot-adjust, more classicizing tendency. He was kind of this half generation after the big three from Utrecht. He studied with Lomart as well. He was recorded in Rome about 1621 for 3 years. Transitioned from Caravaggio's influences into what Hontorst was doing. So we saw the Hontorst, the big concert in the height